It's a fucking mailman.
A mailman? What kind of shit is that? There ain't no address here.
I'll take care of him. Mother, shut up. Packard's covered it.
Okay.
Cotton, take that gun. You know how to use it if you have to. Right between the eyes.
Yes?
Miss Babs Johnson?
Yes, I'm Babs Johnson.
Special delivery package, ma'am. Sign here, please.
What do you mean, special delivery package? There's no address here.
Says right here, Babs Johnson, a trailer, Phoenix, Maryland.
Pink Flamingos is a film that came out in 1972 that's written and directed by John Waters. So Pink Flamingos is the second John Waters film that I now have seen. The first film that I've seen from him was Female Trouble. I have a whole review for that, so please check it out. And I absolutely loved Female Trouble. That's a film that I feel like, in terms of John Waters' filmography, is unfortunately overlooked. And it's a film that I think deserves a lot more praise and a lot more attention. Because to me, that film is by far one of the most absurdly hilarious films that I've ever seen. But obviously, Pink Flamingos is the first film from his entire filmography that I've actually heard of. I've come to learn who John Waters is because of Pink Flamingos and its entire existence and iconography. And as most people were, I was aware that this film contained mountains and mountains of shocking and sensational content. Obviously on not all the specific details, but I was aware that this film basically just had no boundaries and just did whatever the hell it wanted to do. And obviously having seen Female Trouble beforehand, that film gave me a decent idea of what to expect. And after watching Pink Flamingos, I can easily say that this film lives up to its reputation and much more. I feel like no matter what I heard about this film, there was absolutely nothing that was going to properly prepare me for this film. Honestly, there's nothing that anybody can do to prepare somebody for watching this film. You can hypothetically explain every single detail of this film, and that still wouldn't be enough, because hearing it is one thing compared to actually seeing it on screen. That's just a whole different experience. One of the taglines for this film describes it as an exercise in poor taste, and that is putting it so accurately, but at the same time, it's kind of putting it lightly. Because to me, this film is one of the most vile and disgusting pieces of filmmaking that I've ever seen. But at the same time, it's so absurd. In many ways, it's satirical, and a lot of it is gut-bustingly hilarious. Pink Flamingos is entirely a product of its era, obviously being the early 1970s. It's one of many examples of films that came out in the 70s that were a result of filmmakers that explored the newly established MPAA system in every possible avenue. While at the same time, I feel like this film is also a rebellion against what is considered high art, while again, at the same time, being an expressive statement on the current state of America. It's a film that's intentionally non-cinematic. It's a film that's intentionally provocative, and I'm all here for it. I'm all here for it because it's truly unlike anything that you've ever experienced. It's incredibly entertaining. And the non-cinematic aspect of this film, I feel like, is a huge part of its charm. From start to finish, the actors in this film are clearly just actors delivering lines, but it's actually pretty damn effective in a film like this because it gives the film a sense of self-awareness. I feel like the acting style and the way all the dialogue is written is a gigantic part in why this film is so easy to kind of get on board with. And even though you know that all these people are acting, it's actually really impressive in regards to the amount of dialogue that they have to remember, because there are so many scenes in this film where the camera does not cut, and you just see these characters go on for an extensive period of time just delivering a jaw-dropping amount of dialogue, and just the way that they were not only able to memorize all these lines and deliver it in one take, but the way they were kind of able to hit these comedic beats with their vocal expressions, either intentional or unintentional, it's incredibly effective.
And now, Edie, what will it be today? I have grade A extra large. I have grade A large. I have medium. I have small. I have brown. And I have white. Why, look, just look at these. So fresh you could hardly believe it. Why, they're just begging to be scrambled or fried or poached or hard-boiled or all around ready to be thrown into a big fat, juicy omelet. How about it, Edie? Wouldn't it be for the lady that the eggs like the most?
And all the characters that are in this film are incredibly memorable because they're so over the top and so absurd that they all stick out in their own way. One of the more memorable character dynamics of this film is the Eggman and Divine's mother. I love the incorporation of the Eggman in this film because I view the Eggman as like this absurd twist on what we consider to be like a mailman or a milkman when they used to exist. And there's also something that's oddly surreal about his character. I mean, just the way he like opens his briefcase and just showcases all the types of eggs that he has, I feel like I would see something like that in a David Lynch film. And honestly, this entire film I would consider to be a bit surreal because of its levels of absurdity. But what's so interesting about the dynamic between the Eggman and Divine's mother is that as weird and fucked up as that is, it's actually one of the only wholesome things in the entire film. But let's talk about all the crazy shit that's in this film. Don't worry, I'm not gonna spoil any specific details. I'm only gonna vaguely kind of describe things. But this film is filled with so much fucked up imagery that, each time that I witnessed something so twisted and fucked up, I thought, okay, that's probably going to be the most fucked up thing I see in this film. And then it continues to level up time and time again. And I'm really glad that it does that because I feel like that's what made this film a sensation and makes it enthralling from start to finish. And despite the fact that, as I mentioned, it's a product of its era, it's actually timeless. And if anything, got even better with time. But a lot of the content that's in this movie is shocking because it has a sense of humor about literally everything. That's why that one of the taglines of the film is that it's an exercise in poor taste, because it most certainly is. I mean, it has a sense of humor about kidnapping. It has a sense of humor about forced insemination. It has a sense of humor about sexual harassment and sexual assault. It has a sense of humor about animal abuse. So almost every possible thing that you could think of that's offensive, this film has a morbidly dark sense of humor about it. Whether it be incest, whether it be actual physical anuses, whether it be chickens involved with sex. Oh my god, that chicken sex scene was fucked. And it's not only because I know that the chicken had to be harmed in some way to pull that scene off, but mainly because the act of what you're seeing on screen is very unfiltered and it's just repulsive. And I have to make this clear. I feel like I kind of already said it, but I think it's important that I make this clear. Don't ever think that this film is going to hold back at any time. If you feel like, no, this film won't go there, it will, and it does. This is definitely a film only for people who have incredibly high tolerance. And that's another aspect of the film that I really loved, because in a lot of ways, this film is nonconformist as fuck. This is a film that is, you know, again, as I kind of mentioned earlier, is a gigantic statement against the norm. And in a way, I feel like it's set out to kind of remove the mask of America. And I don't mean that in just this vague general way. Specifically, I kind of mean that towards this idea of the traditional family. You know, there's this image that's, you know, been throughout the history of America, even till today, about how the traditional family looks like. And I feel like this film in many different ways is portraying the exact opposite of that. And while doing that, it's kind of exposing how even those people that represent the ideal American image, even those people have all of these filthy desires and have done a lot of immoral stuff that they just hide away from everybody and just bury deep down in their soul. And it makes it to where this film is a gigantic rebellion against tradition in general. Whether it be the traditional values of America, whether it be the traditional way that we perceive high art. Because this film, especially at the time, would be the exact opposite of what film critics would consider to be art. But in all of its trashiness and all of its absurdity and in all of its explorations of poor taste, it actually is artful. Whether or not you value this type of art or think it's meaningful is subjective, but this is art, and it does have things to say. And even beyond that, this film is genuinely creative and well-realized. And I haven't talked about Divine yet, because I feel like it's just obvious how amazing she is. But yeah, she is absolutely killer in this film. I already had so much respect for her after seeing her in Female Trouble, but in this film, She's bizarre. She is a bizarre person, a bizarre actress, and just her commitment to this role and her commitment to this persona is just unfathomable. She goes all the way in this film. She leaves no stone unturned. I mean, every possibility is explored within her character and her performance in this film. Obviously with the iconic ending to this film, which, if you don't know about it, I won't spoil it for you, but, that shit is absolutely disgusting, but at the same time, I respect it. And again, so much talent, just exudes confidence throughout the entire film, and pretty much everything that I've seen her in, and just as a person, just extremely confident. And she delivers her lines incredibly in this film. As I mentioned, a lot of these characters do have monologue-type moments, and she's obviously no exception. There are so many moments in this film where, again, just has mountains of dialogue and is just delivering all of it in the best, most entertaining way I could think of. But obviously, I really love this film. It's one of those films where if you tell somebody you love it and they decide to go watch it, they'll not only question their friendship with you, but they'll just question you as a person. But yeah, obviously, I unashamedly love this film. I'm glad that I finally brought myself to watch it. Criterion's reappraisal and re-release of this film is what finally gave me the push to watch and review it. So I obviously cannot wait to buy this on Criterion. So I'm going to give Pink Flamingos a soft 9 out of 10.
Well, everybody's heard about the bird. Bird. The bird's a winner.
Yeah, obviously not a film for everybody. It's not going to be everybody's cup of tea. But for me, this film works on a lot of different levels. And honestly, as I was reflecting on this film, I realized that there's no way in hell Harmony Korine doesn't want to be this kind of filmmaker. I don't think he's really achieved it to this degree. I think the closest he ever came to that is with Gummo. Cause I really actually do love Gummo. But John Waters is just, he's legendary. He's the pioneer of this kind of shit. And I'm really excited to check out the rest of his filmography. You know, obviously he's made a lot of trash filmmaking like this, but his career is interesting. He's also made, you know, a lot of professional pieces of filmmaking like Serial Mom, or he's even made the family film Hairspray. So he has a wide range of films that are in his filmography, and I'm really interested to go on this journey. But anyways, that's all I got to say about Pink Flamingos. If you really enjoyed what I had to say about the film, just give it a thumbs up and share it amongst your friends. And don't forget to subscribe to the channel to be updated on more film-related content.